Hi everyone, this is Professor Benjamin, and this video serves as a walkthrough of the midterm exam. So I sent out a couple announcements about the midterm exam in roundups from week 4 and week 5, and so this is just going to kind of give you a walkthrough. So the midterm exam review can be actually found right here under the sustainability session. You'll see the review for the midterm exam. I'm going to open that review and we're going to walk through it. So you're given 1 hour and actually 3 hours, and each answer needs to be at least a full paragraph in length. So this is an all essay exam. What's fantastic is you're given all of the questions before the midterm exam has started. So what I think you should do is type out the answers on this midterm exam review sheet, and then you can copy and paste them into the portal while you're taking the midterm. And then that way, you kind of have prepared for the midterm before the actual midterm exam has even begun, which is fantastic. So here you go. The midterm can be found under separate module titled midterm. And so depending upon what semester you're in, we'll determine those dates. Those dates were given to you in both the syllabus and in the announcements. I have those dates posted. So you're given over the week one chance to take the midterm and 3 hours. I do not suggest that you wait until that time period to take the midterm exam, meaning, remember, if you start the midterm exam, you have to give yourself a 3 hour window. So it's not like you can start the midterm, stop it, and then another day pick up on it. It has to be taken in one sitting. So take note to that. So I would find a quiet room for 3 hours to take your midterm. If you are writing out your answers before the midterm, typing out your answers before the midterm exam should probably only take you about 10 or 15 minutes because you're just copying and pasting into the midterm exam portal. So I would really suggest that you type out the answers. And the reason I keep saying this is because I've run into a lot of situations where students open the midterm exam. They're saying, oh, I have plenty of time. I have 3 hours. And that 3 hours goes by really fast when you're trying to look up answers and develop paragraph answers for each question. The other thing is that a lot of times students' portals freeze because they have too many tabs open. So they, you know, they have their exam tab open in Canvas, and then they have all these other tabs open. Sometimes they accidentally X out of the exam when they're Xing out of another document. All of that can be alleviated if you type out the answers before the midterm exam. The other thing is all the answers need to be in your own words. That means that I don't want you to copy and paste text from either an article or the textbook. I need you to explain that you understand the material. So everything needs to be in your own words. That means you either have to paraphrase the information. I don't want to see quotations or anything of that nature. All the sources you use have to be given to you from me in the modules. There's only one question, and I tell you in the question that you can use an outside source, and then you need to cite that source because you're using it from outside the material that I've given you. Everything else, I know the material inside out and backwards, and I'll know whether you have developed those answers from the material I've given you or from some outside source. If it is from an outside source and I tell you that you cannot do that, then you're going to receive a zero for that question. The reason I do, the reason I give essay answers is because I can give partial credit. If I just give you multiple choice questions, then it's only right or wrong. So that's why I think it's really important to give you this so that you have, you're able to develop these answers and I can give you partial credit. So here we go. So there's some information up here. You should read this. Each answer should be at least one full paragraph in length. While there may be certain parts to the question, the entire answer could be one paragraph in length. I really think that most of these questions are going to require more than one paragraph in length answer in order for you to get across your point. So the least that it can be is one full paragraph in length, but I would like them to be more because in order to answer some of these questions, you're going to need more than one paragraph to relay your thoughts. So here's, notice I have them in sessions, meaning these deal with each module. So session one would deal with module one. And under there are two questions. What are the main reasons for uncertainty in our understanding of the environment? And how does the scientific method help us remove uncertainty from science? This probably is a two paragraph answer, one for explaining the first part of the question and one for explaining the second part of the question. And if you notice next to the question, I actually tell you where you can find the answer. So this can be found in the textbook chapter related to session one, which in this case is chapter one of the textbook. So you can find that answer. The second one is, why are negative and positive feedback loops important for the environment? This can be found in the textbook chapter related to session one. And that is, I do not just want the answer to be because they bring about homeostasis. That is what they do, but I want you to explain what homeostasis is and what a negative and positive feedback loop are. So remember, each answer needs to be at least a full paragraph in length. So in order to get to that four sentences, you're going to need to elaborate. So you can't just write, because they bring about homeostasis, I'm just going to mark that probably wrong. I need you to have a full paragraph in answer in length. The next deals with session two, which is tragedy of the commons. And you'll see here, these three questions deal directly with the tragedy of the commons article by Garrett Hardin. You can always go back and listen to my roundups, because I've given you some information based on these. So why do we use mutual corrosion to protect the commons, and does it work as per the article? Why does a welfare state not help to protect the commons? Why do technical solutions not work in solving the problems? Commons problem. So each one of these questions can be found. They may be together or they may be separated on the midterm exam. So I would prepare a paragraph under each question. And then that way, when you see it on the midterm exam, you can either edit your answer or elaborate on your answer. All of those can be found in the document by Garrett Hardin called The Tragedy of the Commons. Here is another one. When are invasive species considered a tragedy of the commons? Remember, not all invasive species are tragedy of the commons. Look at the tragedy of the commons PowerPoint. So I tell you right there where to really go to try and understand this concept. Session three, this deals with chapter two in your textbook. Explain how our current views of the environment have been formed. Be sure to include why religion plays a role in your answer. So make sure you talk about how we've become detached from nature, how those views have been formed over time, domestication of plants and animal, monotheistic religions, the Industrial Revolution, agricultural revolution, all of those things play a role. I need you to elaborate on those. The next one is, can we put a monetary value on clean air and forests? Of course we can. It's just not accurate. And then I need you to list reasons why it's not accurate. And this deals with contingent valuations. What are those controversies? What are also the controversies dealing with ecological valuation? You're going to need to use your textbook as well as the Pricing the Priceless article. So you're going to need to use those two sources in there. Remember, if you're using outside sources, I can easily tell that you're not using the text or the articles to create your answers, and that is definitely a no-no. Preservation and conservation. Explain the difference between a conservationist and a preservationist. If you go to Google, I will totally know if you go to Google to find these answers. You need to use the textbook to find out what these two terms mean. I know there will be a percentage of you who answers that preservationist is to preserve buildings and architecture and buildings. That is not as per this class. As per this class, it's hands-off nature. So you want to look that up. And then here, how was Hetch Hetchy controversy a decisive moment between conservationists and preservationists? This right here, I tell you right here, you can use an outside source, but you must cite that source that you use to find that answer. The next one is session four. This is consumption session. Why can we not live on a linear system in a finite world? And how does our consumption activities addressed in the story of stuff contribute to the issues surrounding linear systems? So you're definitely going to talk about what is a line system, meaning there's an input and an output, and that output is not put back into the input, so we just end up with garbage. And then you, of course, want to talk about externalization of cost, perceived obsolescence, and planned obsolescence, and how they play a part in us in this linear system. So I want you to tie those terms to linear system and why they play a role in linear system. So make sure you can use the video The Story of Stuff, but I do not want you to paraphrase the video Story of Stuff. We already know, I do not want you to summarize The Story of Stuff. We all have watched the video, so we understand what it means. I need you to tie that material to answer the question. So this is critical thinking. It's not just regurgitating information to me. I want you to apply the terms that are used to answer a question. So make sure you take that into mind. Session five, which is sustainability, I want you to talk about fair trade. What is fair trade? Why is fair trade coming under criticism? You know, big farms are trying to get in on fair trade. Does that remove the term fair trade, if a big plantation now is getting in on a small on in what we consider small farming and the proceeds going directly to the small farmer, I don't know. So that's for you to answer. Why is the labeling of food, organic food, being grouped into the same category as fair trade? Remember, there's no clear set of rules for organic or fair trade, and that's a huge problem. There's too many loopholes. So a lot of you think when you're getting organic food that you're getting it from a small farmer that's not using any pesticides. That's not true. They are allowed to use organic pesticides, and a lot of them come from plantations, main plantations that are creating all of your conventional food is also growing your organic food right next to each other. So you want to take that into account, and you can find these answers in the podcasts and the articles that can be found under the under the sustainability module. So make sure you answer those questions. And then session six, what is the difference between 160 calories in almonds compared to 160 calories in soda? I want you to answer that question based upon the film Fed Up, which means you're going to actually have to cite examples from Fed Up in your answer. So you can't just say, this is why. I want you to give specific examples from the film so I know you've watched the film in there. And that would be, and that's going to create your answer. Please take note to this. The answer needs to be at least 200 words in length. And remember that containing sources from the film means examples from the film. Okay, so I want you to say, well, as per the film, they talked about this, and this is why this answer is this. Okay, so make sure you take that into account as you're answering your midterm exam question. So overall, this is the midterm exam. You're going to have 3 hours, and 1 week, one chance in 1 week to take the midterm exam. All of those dates are given to you in the syllabus and in the course modules. If you have any further questions about the midterm exam, feel free to ask, and I hope you succeed on your midterm exam by using the tips that I've given you in this video.